that can show us the fluid beauty in a drop of milk and capture a speeding bullet in mid-flight. He helped us win a war by lighting up the French countryside and froze the first instant of an atomic blast. He uses sound to make pictures that help find sunken ships.
All right, go.
His machines rearrange bits of time and motion and expand the limits of our vision. His name is Harold Edgerton, but everyone calls him Doc.
Major funding for NOVA is provided by this station and other public television stations nationwide. Additional funding was provided by the Johnson & Johnson family of companies, supplying healthcare products worldwide. And Allied Corporation, a world leader in advanced technology products for the aerospace, automotive, chemicals, and electronics industries.
The Massachusetts Institute of Technology. In 1927, while Harold Edgerton was a graduate student of engineering here, he designed a magic lamp, the stroboscope. Edgerton's strobe became an indispensable tool of science, industry, and art. It could flash a million times a second, and it revolutionized the way we see.
If you're working with anything, and you want to understand it, you've got to see it and record it and learn all about it.
Lightning. Electrical energy transformed into bursts of brilliant light. If you bottle this light and make it reliable and precise, you have the secret of Edgerton's strobe.
Happy birthday to you.
Today, the strobe is familiar as the flash on the family snapshot camera and as the timing light in workshops and garages. At airports around the world, strobe lights guide planes safely home. And strobes make possible pictures of things no human eye can see.
Your eyes aren't designed for speed. You shoot a bullet through here, you won't even see it. You won't know anything about it at all. So you have to have strobe.
In his lab at MIT, Doc Edgerton takes a high-speed photograph of a bullet in flight. The only light at the instant of exposure will be from one of his magic lamps, an electronic strobe, and will last only 1/1,000,000th of a second. Lights out.
You have to have a strobe to see it. So, why not call it a magic lamp? What's magic lamp mean to you? It's something that other you never saw before. It dazzles you. Well, that's what it does. From a photographic standpoint, if you never used an electronic flash lamp and you suddenly had one, you'd say, hey, this is terrific. Look at all the things it can do.
Is this before the drop hit or is it after the drop hit?
After one drop.
Same sort of thing.
People like it because it puts the action into a form is frozen so that you can recognize what's happening.
So that there's also an aesthetic quality of beauty in motion. And that
it's supposed to be real art. Well, I don't care. That's all right. If they want to call it art, well, they call it art. Well, I really think of myself as a more electrical engineer. I want to get the message across.
The strobe's gone off.
Educational experience.
This one, the strobe went off at the time he let go of the arrow.
Well, high-speed photography really started a long time ago. The first photography was ever done was by a fellow in England named Fox Talbot.
Talbot demonstrated that unblurred photographs could be made of fast-moving objects. In 1851, he used the electric spark from a primitive battery to effectively freeze the image of the London Times as it spun around on a revolving wheel. This was the first stop-action photograph, and Fox Talbot's technique was called spark photography. By the end of the century, spark photography was used occasionally in scientific experiments. High-speed, close-up pictures of splashes were made by physics professor A.M. Worthington, using sparks of very brief duration, only 1/100,000th of a second. The pictures were remarkable, but they lacked detail. Spark photography remained a laboratory curiosity until Harold Edgerton developed the strobe 30 years later. Only then could pictures like this one be made, a milk drop in perfect detail at 1/1,000,000th of a second. But it wasn't to examine a splash of milk that Doc designed the strobe. It was to solve an engineering problem, part of his doctoral thesis. He needed to measure the moving parts of a high-speed synchronous motor. First, he made a mathematical model.
I solved these problems theoretically. So then the next problem was, does the real motor in the real world do the same thing? And it's a difficult measurement to make. It has to be done to measure the rotor, the angle. Well, you can't do it electrically, you have to do it optically. So that's how I happened to say, well, the strobe will do it. Then the strobe has to have enough power and energy so you can take movies, so we can plot these things, because they happen real quick, you know. The duration of flash is about a little less than 10 microseconds. That's 100,000 of a second. That was a remarkable thing. Everybody looked at this motor, it was going at high speed. It was just as sharp and clear as if it was standing still.
The principle of Edgerton's innovation had long been understood, that light flashing at exactly the same rate as a rotating object would freeze the object's motion. Edgerton's strobe was revolutionary because it flashed so rapidly that even extremely fast-moving objects could be stopped, and it was so bright that clear, detailed pictures could be made.
And once you had it, everything was easy. I'd worked for 3 years on motors, and I suddenly realized, hey, there's a lot of things in the world that move. I looked around, and there was a faucet over there, just right next to where I was working. So I just moved the strobe over and took a picture of this water coming out of the faucet. And that was the first picture I ever took, except for a motor. Important things about all high-speed photography is getting it at the right instant. And there are all kinds of ways to do this. And the simplest one from bullets standpoint is to use a simple microphone. So when the shock wave hits the microphone, it turns on the light. And if you don't like it, move the microphone just a little bit and you can get the whole sequence.
Doc checks out the microphone that triggers the strobe. The timing must be perfect. Although he's made this shot 10,000 times, he takes careful aim.
If you just show the bullet, people look at it and say, how did you hang that up there? Where's the string? I don't see the string. But if you put the apple in there, you can tell that apple was hit by that bullet, and that bullet is moving fast.
Doc's fascination with things in motion led him to make another new kind of photograph with his strobe. He called it multi-flash. By flashing the strobe on his subject while the camera shutter remains open, he makes a sequence of exposures on a single piece of film. One exposure for each flash.
Hello, Sandy.
Here's how he does
it. Thanks a lot for coming over.
So I want you to say hello to Ellen Dixon.
Hi.
Sandy Young, she's going to do some acrobatics for the motor flash. And be sure to watch. You're going to run the camera for me. I'm going to run the lights. We're going to make a team. Try to catch her in the air. Would you come over here? Now be careful. We're getting you up in the air a little bit so we can get a picture from a low camera.
Okay.
And be sure to hit that corner over there. And you come down. And this light, I want to see you do it first, just like you're going to do it, so Ellen can judge it. All right, ready? One, two, three, go. Perfect. Now, this time I'm going to flash the light on you.
Okay.
And don't get excited when it flashes when you're upside down there. Just ignore the light.
Okay.
Ready? All right, go. Fine. Now, we're going to make it more difficult. We're going to turn out all the lights.
Okay.
And open the shutter when I say open, and then we'll take a series of pictures of her on the film. Get ready. One, two, three, four, five, six. Perfect. So that's all there is to mole flash photography, getting the right light, and the right subject, and the right film, and the right flashes all together, and then you get a nice picture.
In his stroboscopic light laboratory at MIT, Doc has been teaching and figuring things out for over 50 years. He is one of only a dozen distinguished institute professors, and he's something of an institution here himself. He's been officially retired since 1968. But nearly every day, Doc plays around with his contraptions in the lab. He delights in demonstrating the properties of various materials. Here, neon gas.
Neon. This is a glow from high voltage, high frequency coming out of this spark coil. It goes right through the glass and excites them, the neon atoms. They give a red color when they recombine.
Gases are a critical component of every strobe. It is the gas inside each lamp that, when charged with electric current, produces the flash. In the early days of electronic strobe, every lamp was specially designed and custom made of hand-blown glass. Doc made many of them himself.
This is a setup for making electronic flash tubes. One of the flash tubes is here. This is the anode and the cathode, and it's connected to a vacuum system. First, I have to suck the air out of it. You'll hear the pump. I hope you can. The pump is pulling the air out, and I'll let it pump for a while to be sure this air gets out of here. Okay, close enough, zero. And I'll turn this pump off. Then I'll turn on the argon gas. It comes out of this big tank over here. There's about 2 centimeters of argon. Turn the valve off, and I'll test it. You can see the argon gas in there. And I'll put the voltage on. This is the switch that turns on the high voltage. That's 2,000 volts right there. And this is the button that makes it go. Hey, look at that. So that's the way we make flash lamps. And
all the high school kids use flash. Everybody uses flash. It comes free. It's like the sun. It's there. Shoot.
During a trip to his hometown of Aurora, Nebraska, Doc runs into a local photographer who is a fan of him and his work.
What's that blinking light you got on that thing?
That's a strobe light invented by a guy by the name of Edgerton, I think, way back in the 1800s, wasn't it? No, I don't remember when he did that, but it was a fantastic invention.
Oh, that was just last week that invention came.
Is that right?
Yeah, well, strobe lights are modern.
They are.
They didn't have them in the old days. They were all made in Boston, in Cambridge. And I designed them, and we built them, and had the lamps made, and we were trying to get Eastman to sell them.
Yeah, well...
That worked out pretty well.
I don't remember if it was 40 or 41, but I know that my dad bought one of the very first sets. And
well, it was before the war.
Harold Eugene Edgerton was born in nearby Fremont, Nebraska, in 1903. His family moved to Washington, D.C., but they preferred small-town life. So in 1916, Doc came back to Aurora. Then, as now, the courthouse was a landmark of the town.
There were 4 200-watt lamps up there. And they used to burn out. And I had a job in the electric light plant, so I would have to come down and climb up the stairs and reach out way out over the... unscrew that bulb. I can still remember it's a long way down. After I graduated from high school here,
I went down to the University of Nebraska because I was interested in electricity. I intended to go back and work for the electric light people here. And my father said I ought to go east and go to MIT. Well, I never heard of the place, but I asked a student from Aurora who'd gone to Harvard whether he'd heard of it. And he said, oh, yeah. He said, looked me in the eye and said, they only take smart people. I didn't take the hint.
And it was a good thing, too, because it was during his graduate studies in electrical engineering here that Doc designed and developed the strobe. The first commercial prototype was ready by 1931. Edgerton joined forces with two former students, Herbert Grier and Kenneth Germeshausen, and it wasn't long before there was a whole battery of magic lights for many specialized uses. The still pictures they made were dazzling, but Doc wanted to use strobes to make high-speed movies. He designed a new type of camera that could whip film through 1,000 frames per second in synchronization with a pulsing strobe. As always, he drew upon everyday life for his subject matter. Never seen movies like these before. News spread far and wide about Doc's invention. Before long, a man from Hollywood came calling.
He said, I work for MGM and I'd like to invite you to come to Hollywood and show this camera to all of our people, and we'll take some pictures with it, and maybe we'll make a short with Pete Smith, who was their comedian.
The film was called Quicker Than a Wink, and it won a 1936 Academy Award for MGM.
First, Charlie Lacey will hit the ball through this telephone book. Maybe. Here it comes. Wow, look at that. Charlie has ruined a lot of good names and good phone numbers, too. Woo-hoo! I always thought that my cat, in lapping her milk, curled her tongue up. But now it's revealed that she curls her tongue down. See? In other words, she brings the milk up on the underside of her tongue. Now, see how smart you get when you go to the movie? Most of you have heard, and perhaps have even felt, that cute little drill.
Wow, there it goes.
And so it is with this happy thought that we reluctantly bid farewell to stroboscope and sail into the setting sun.
Doc and his colleagues added the finishing touch, adding slow motion sound to high speed pictures.
Thank you.
These days, Doc uses a modern version of his early high-speed camera to film a slow-motion sequence of milk drops.
Now, ready to fill up the dripper. Well, we're going to try to make this milk drop splash into a crown shape on a plate. So I'll put this plate on here, and then I'll let the drop come down. The first drop will give me some milk to work on. And then the second one will hit the first drop and make the crown.
Like a series of individual colored drops filmed in slow motion. But it's actually a stream of water being pushed out by a pump in separate pulses, splashing onto a metallic plate at normal speed. The individual drops are revealed by a strobe flashing at the same rate as the pulsing of the pump. Doc calls it his fiddler machine, and he loves to show it to people.
What it is a pump pumping some water with a little dye in it, and it looks like a continuous stream. But if you shine a light on it that's flashing 60 times a second, it shows that it's actually a series of drops because the pump is working intermittently. And you can make it appear to go either down or up by changing the frequency of the light.
I used to play with this
in the exhibit in the hall. There's two push buttons.
Therapeutic.
The visitors can push one, gives them an ordinary light, and they push the other button, gives them a strobe light. Or they can push the two buttons together.
Play with it if you want.
Doc has a portable fiddler, which he takes with him all over the world to demonstrate the strobe. Today, he takes it into a restaurant in his Nebraska hometown.
Come on over a little closer. You got to be close. You can't be standoffish in this business. You ready?
Yes.
You ready?
Yes.
Okay. Now watch it real close.
Isn't that Drop pretty? When you show the light on it, that's what causes it.
But your eyes can't tell it. Your eyes are no good for anything that moves fast. I like to see people recognize they've seen something they never saw before and that they've learned something. Their eyes open up and they're so awed by what they see. That's a good educational shock.
Now watch it. Hey, don't go away. You ready?
Okay.
Turn the knob makes a difference. The whistle has nothing to do with it. Now you fellas, since you've been so cooperative, you got a prize. Yeah.
Thank you.
That's the way we make applesauce back here at MIT. But we don't recommend it.
Well, you take a picture of a bullet, you go in a dark room, you put the camera on the bulb, you open the camera up, and the bullet comes through. Sound hits the microphone, turns the light on for a minute of a second, makes your exposure, then you close the shutter and change the film.
Ever since I've been here, I've been giving lecture demonstrations. I drag in all kinds of equipment, run it, and let the students see it. My argument is that that's the way to get to the real world, is to go out and work with it.
And now I want to demonstrate this big strobe over here. Would you like to see a big one? Okay, here's a big one. And this is a strobe light. This is not a portable job. You don't attach this to the camera. But this was made in the war when we were having trouble with the Germans, and we used to want to know what they were doing at nighttime. Well, you fly over to France and Germany and see what they're doing.
During World War II, keeping track of enemy troops was essential, but difficult even in the daytime. At night, the only way was to take photographs from an airplane flying at 10,000 feet, using leftover flash powder bombs from World War I. But it required clear skies, and the flash bombs could blow up right in the plane. The military was looking for something better. So in 1938, they called on Harold Edgerton.
Well, one Saturday afternoon, we were down in the lab here working, and a fellow came in and said, where's that blinking light that I hear about? And I said, it's all right there.
The fellow was Colonel George W. Goddard of the Air Force Photographic Lab. He wanted Edgerton to create a new type of strobe for aerial reconnaissance, one powerful enough to allow pictures to be taken from an airplane flying at only a few thousand feet. Doc and his associates went to work on the top secret project. The end result was a strobe package that produced more than 57,000 watt seconds of light, powered by 8 kilowatts, weighing 3,700 pounds. Its power was impressive, as Edgerton enjoys demonstrating.
You ready to go, Bill? All right, get ready. 1, 2, 3, push. Went up my yardstick.
The new strobes worked wonders. So Doc went to war to assemble a squadron of night photo pilots. But the pilots resisted. They wanted to fight the war, not take pictures of it.
So we had a morale problem. Couldn't get anybody to fly. That's when I worked up that nudist camp story. I heard about this nudist camp out near England, there somewhere, near London. I found the coordinates, so I knew exactly where it was, and I was told I wanted the volunteers to go out and take some pictures. And immediately they perked right up, and they flew so low that people on the ground were spelling out things with the towels, you see, reporting you. It was a lot of fun. And they finally got interested in it because it's a real challenge.
The Americans had been won over, but our European allies weren't convinced that strobes could do the job.
We had a big meeting up in London somewhere. Everybody sat around a table and drank coffee and finally said, hey, there's too much talk. You're none of action. Why don't we go out and take some target? And you try your no-good system and we'll try ours and we'll see if it's as bad. And that appealed to them. So they said, well, we don't know what target to try. I said, I can suggest one that nobody will complain about in the slightest. And they said, what's that? And it's Stonehenge. I said, it's out in the country. There's no lights around it. And nobody lives out there. And it's a nice big thing, and it's easy to photograph. We'll take night photos of Stonehenge.
And they did. This startling aerial view was made with a strobe. The Edgerton Airborne Photographic System was a success, and it went to work for the Allied cause. Its value was demonstrated dramatically the night before the invasion of Normandy, June 6, 1944. The pictures made with strobes showed little or no movement of enemy troops, indicating that the Germans were unprepared for the invasion.
The clouds were down about 1,000 feet, and the flash bombs couldn't be used at all because they were designed to be working at 10,000 feet. So those pictures were useful. They were used all during the war.
The atomic bomb brought the end of World War II. And it ushered in an era of nuclear research. The government called on Edgerton again, this time for his expertise in specialized high-speed photography. The Atomic Energy Commission was making above-ground tests of atomic devices on Pacific islands like Eniwetok Atoll. Edgerton and his MIT associates, Germeshausen and Grier, formed a company, which later became EG&G, Inc., and designed a testing camera to analyze nuclear explosions.
High-speed cameras capable of taking several million separate pictures per second are placed close to zero point, they will record the story of nuclear forces from a vantage point where man himself dares not stand.
10 seconds, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
Nearly every picture the public has ever seen of a nuclear explosion was made with the equipment designed by EG&G. These devices also film the effects of atomic blasts on buildings. Edgerton's high-speed cameras made it possible to watch what actually happened.
If you blow up an atom bomb, it happens instantly. Most shutters are way too slow, so we built some magneto-optic shutters that work in a millionth of a second. I had a long focus telescope, and you want to know what's going on in the early stages. No, we're scientists working on the facts. Our role is to find out everything we can about the thing. And that was where it started. EG&G Incorporated started right after the war as a in-house captive thing for the nuclear energy. And we hired a lot of people, and we set off a lot of atom bombs and did a lot of experimental things. And then suddenly one day we had an agreement with the Russians not to have any more atom bombs. And all my friends came around here and said, oh, it's too bad your company's going down a drain because the Russians and Americans are going to not do it anymore. And I said, oh, yeah. I learned a lot long ago not to get excited when people panic. Well, that was the best year we ever had because all the people got up early in the morning and started thinking about other things to do. And was all kinds of things to do.
EG&G began to grow, and it now has 160 different operations all over the world. It manufactures electronics for space stations and submarines, geologists and doctors. They employ 21,000 people and have sales of over $1 billion a year. But success didn't overwhelm Doc's principal fascination, looking at the natural world. One of his favorites was Spooky the Owl at Boston's Museum of Science.
All right, let him go. Terrific.
Well, birds are awfully hard to catch, to get them timed and get them in front of the camera and get them photographed. You have to have strobe to get real sharp, distinctive pictures of the wingtips that are going high velocity.
But spectacular as these photographs were, Doc had a hard time getting them published until one evening.
I went to Rochester, New York to a cocktail party, and there was a bunch of people up there in this old Eastman house, and over in the corner was an old gray-haired man standing all by himself drinking a ginger ale. So I went over and had a ginger ale and went over and talked to him, and I said, my name's Harold Edgerton. He says, mine is Gilbert Grosvenor. And I said, Gilbert Grosvenor? I said, aren't you the fellow that runs that Yellowback magazine down here in Washington? Yeah, yeah. He said, well, I said, I'm glad to meet you because I've been writing letters to you for about 2 years now. And I get back these bedbug letters saying, no, we don't. And he said, what was it about? And I said, it's about bird photography. There's a new method of photography that's going to photograph birds with the wings sharp and clear. He says, is that right? We says, from now on, send all the letters marked to me personal. And from then on, I had a friend in the house. And Geographic has been full of bird pictures.
Doc's curiosity took him next into oceans and rivers. He developed a strobe system that worked underwater, and he combined it with a camera that made time-lapse exposures, one frame every 10 seconds, to speed up motion instead of slowing it down.
I built three units, and we were going to go out and steady the sediments in the harbor, because every day the tides are going in, tides coming out, and they're taking the mud, moving it around, and I was going to put those down there and learn how that mud moves. Well, it just shows that the landlubber can't visualize what's going on in the sea because the bottom doesn't move. It's the mud goes through and the gravel stays And it's covered by all kinds of wildlife down there. And lo and behold, these movies were okay. They showed starfish and all kinds of things walking around on the bottom. The human being is no good for looking at starfish. If you look at starfish on sitting on the bottom, he just sits there. That's because your time reference frame is no good. He's actually moving very slowly. And when you speed him up 200 times, he's going around doing all kinds of things. One thing just led to another, because I got a telephone call that said there was some unknown man came in from France, a young Frenchman with a big nose and a named Jacques Cousteau. Nobody ever heard of him, but he's here, and could he come up and talk to you about underwater photography? Well, I said, sure, I'll talk to anybody. So he came in, and I found out he'd invented the Aqualung, and he hadn't been in MIT more than a couple of hours before we had a tank on his back, and he was testing my latest underwater strobe in the swimming pool. And that led to many, many expeditions on the Calypso and a lot of articles in the Geographic. I think he was here for 24 hours, and we worked out enough programs to last us for another 100 years. We haven't finished him yet. When you go out in the ocean, you look around, you see nothing but water. You know that down the bottom there's all kinds of interesting things happening down there. We took pictures of the bottom of the sea. Up to that time, there were very few pictures been made of the bottom of the sea, showing what's down there.
But the strobe's beam could only illuminate a narrow underwater path. And if the water was murky, the strobe was no good at all. Doc needed a new tool to help make good pictures underwater. Enter sonar. Sonar devices have long been used aboard ships to monitor the water depth below. They send out sound waves which hit the bottom and reflect back. The time between the signal and its echo indicates the depth of the water. Doc was working with Cousteau in the Mediterranean when, with characteristic resourcefulness, he thought of a new way to use the old device.
The first sonar, as I recall it, there may be a little truth in this, was we pulled into Toulon Harbor one night, late in the evening, and we'd been trying to get photos of the bottom. And in midwater, there's no problem because the camera just takes pictures, bang, bang, bang. But when you get close to the bottom, if you get too low, the camera goes into the bottom, and that doesn't work. If it's too high, it doesn't work. So the problem was to get a ticker, and put it right on the camera, and then listen to it from the surface, and get the echo from the bottom, and get the direct signal from the pinger. And by measuring the time between these two, tick, tick, and only velocity sound, we can say, ha-ha, the camera's 20 feet high, lower 10 feet. It's almost like magic to be on a ship and watch this little scope and say to the sailor, hey, drop that camera 10 feet. Raise it 10 feet. Yeah, that worked wonders.
Doc thought sonar might be able to see a completely unexplored part of the underwater world. Below the bottom, into the mud, where all sorts of things are buried. Back at MIT, he developed the mud pinger, a penetrating sonar device. The pinger reveals the contours of whatever is buried below. Geological formations, archaeological treasures, sunken ships, or the pair of tunnels beneath Boston Harbor.
Okay, this is a what we call a penetrating sonar. It's a rather low frequency. It's down around 3 to 5, 6 kilocycles. These are transmitters that the Navy uses for looking for submarines, made by a NASA company down in Hingham. And when I put an electrical signal onto this, it gives a ping. The sound will go up and hit the ceiling, come back and hit the receiver, and I measure the time that it takes for the signal to go up and go back. Now when we use it, we turn it over and put it in the water, and the first signal that comes back is from the bottom, and then some of this energy goes into the bottom, like when we're looking for the tunnels, and hit the top of the tunnel, which is down about 15 feet, and gives me an echo from it. So with this machine, I can find those tunnels. I'd like to have you listen to it run. Now I'll turn on the pinger. Now if I move it over a little bit, I can see that fluorescent lamp, I hope. How about giving it a push, Bill? And line it right up with the fluorescent lamp. And you'll notice that the distance from the fluorescent lamp to the transmitter is considerably less than from the ceiling to the
transmitter.
At first, the paper printout looks like a series of undistinguished lines, but it is actually a vertical cross-section of the room. This thick, dark line is the transmitter. The top line is the ceiling, and the intermediate band is the fluorescent light fixture. This shadowy line is the ceiling above the light fixture. This image was made near the mouth of Boston Harbor. Below the bottom is the geological thumbprint of the Ice Age, a terminal moraine, a solid granite core marking the edge of the glacier as it moved into the sea 20,000 years ago. This image, made in Boston's inner harbor, shows a more uniform bottom. But buried 15 feet below it are two large objects, the Sumner Tunnel and its twin, the Callahan, carrying millions of cars a year under the harbor between the city of Boston and Logan Airport. Because they're a permanent part of Boston Harbor's underwater profile, Doc uses them to test new sonar devices. He goes out every chance he gets.
And our pet target is the tunnels that go over the airport. Two tunnels. And when we go out with this machine, we can't find them. We know there's something wrong with the equipment or us, because those tunnels stay there.
Doc and his two assistants test out a new modification on the pinger. They hold course across the harbor as the submerged pinger scans the bottom. Each pass should give a distinct, if faint, image of the tunnels below.
Most sonars use just to find the bottom. I want to find not only the bottom, but what's below the bottom. And there are all kinds of archaeological, geological things that are buried under the bottom of the ocean. And equipment is marginal. It helps sometimes, sometimes it doesn't. So it's got to be made better.
And Doc has another underwater sonar system, which reveals the shape of objects that stick up above the ocean floor. It produces images like this one of a sunken ship.
Well, this is a side scan sonar made by EG&G, and it hangs in the water from the cable that Bill's holding up there. And the sound comes out of these black panels, and it comes out in a thin dimension along the travel, and a thick perpendicular to the travel. And there's one on the other side, so as this goes through the water, it presents a picture from the surface of the bottom from both directions. It's called a side scan, because it does, it side scans. It's a very valuable instrument because it shows things that are sticking up from the bottom. They come up very loud and clear.
I was in Athens with Cousteau on the Calypso, and he came in one day and said, is that side scan sonar good for picking up a ship that's 1,000 feet long? Think you can find it? Well, I said, if I can't, we better go home with the sonar. You ought to be able to find it in no time.
They were looking for the HMS Britannic, a sister ship of the famed Titanic, launched just 6 months before World War I. It, too, was doomed, sunk by a German mine off the coast of Greece. Edgerton joined Cousteau and the Calypso in their filmed search for the Britannic. The boat's crew called him Papa Flash.
Hour after hour, under the watchful eye of Dr. Harold Edgerton, famed electronics inventor, the sonar signals reveal a lengthening profile of the sea bottom.
Then we went out and looked. The next time we found it. It was a long ways from where anybody ever thought. There it was, just as clear and sharp. And Cousteau dived on it and took a movie on it. It's one of his specialty movies. Fantastic. He dived on with his little submarine, because it's about 350 feet deep. With his submarine, he could do it.
And there were other wrecks to find. The Civil War battle between the USS Monitor and the Confederate Merrimack is legendary in maritime history. The two ironclad ships fought to a standoff in 1866, each claiming victory. A year later, the Monitor fell victim to a storm and sunk off the coast of Cape Hatteras, North Carolina. It was lost to history for more than 100 years. Then, in 1973, Doc decided he'd try to find it.
The Monitor was a Civil War ship that was sunk long, long time ago. A very famous ship. It had a marvelous history. And the question was, where is the Monitor? And lots of people had looked for it, and they claimed they found it. But when they went back, there was nothing there. So it was like Loch Ness Monster. I mean, a lot of people have seen it, but you can't go back and pull the body out and exhibit it. So I knew that the Monitor had to be somewhere. And the question was how to find it. We discovered the Monitor with a side scan sonar, and that's a sample of the side scan sonar. That's the kind that found it. This ship confused them a long time because the turret is underneath it, and it tipped over and the turret fell off. Finally, the archaeologist said, no, that ship's upside down. When it went down, it tipped over and it went down boing on its tail end and broke the propeller off. This is a boiler. And then it fell down on top of the turret.
And there it was, revealed for the first time by underwater cameras.
Excellent shots. Look at that. Some of those corals are really quite large, aren't they?
Well, that's a good shot of the gun port. We really got it. Yeah, it looks really good, Richard. Looks good.
Edgerton's notebooks are full of the records of his success. But as every scientist knows, for each experiment that works, there are many failures.
Every experiment's a success. And the ones that don't work are really more important than the ones that do work, because you can check them off. And I think that's one of the things that students need to learn, is that most of the things you do in life are a failure. When you find out what the failures are, and then you don't do it that way next time.
Right now I'm working on raindrops. The student I'm working with and I want to know, why aren't raindrops bigger than a certain size?
Okay, you ready?
I'm ready. Let's go.
Okay, everything's on.
Everything's on.
Okay, go.
Ready. Looks like you got it.
Well, let's develop the film and see what happens.
The thing I really like about working with Doc is that he doesn't feel like he needs to have $500,000 worth of expensive equipment to do the sort of research that he likes to do. All the questions that he likes to answer, all the questions that he asks are fundamental questions about what occurs in nature, things that people haven't seen before, things that people, you know, that at least he's interested in seeing.
Turn on the lights, Peter.
Each new roll of film that we develop is a chance to learn something new about the thing that we're studying. We first started on this problem over the summer, and all we were doing was we were pouring water down a staircase in one of the buildings over here at MIT. Just Doc downstairs with a camera and me upstairs with a pump, and we were spraying it over the edge of a railing. And as we got more and more involved with this, it got more sophisticated.
Well, we got a more uniform exposure with that heavier diffuser. Keep putting scratches on the film here.
It's an exciting process for Doc, because for Doc, it's a chance to learn something he hasn't learned yet.
Here we go.
He wants to turn on the lights even before the film is fixed completely, just because he wants to see it already. And even when the film hasn't cleared and it's still white in the fixer, and I'm cringing because I'm thinking about, oh no, the film's going to be ruined. He's got it up against the light and he's looking at it with its loop and he's saying, hey, look at that, that's really great.
Okay, so here comes the drop, falling through the field, kabam.
Beautiful, look at that. Now it's breaking away into small drops.
Right.
Beautiful.
He's got a lot of ideas that he wants to follow through with, and when he wants to do something, he says, well, come on, let's go. And when he doesn't want to do something, he says, well, I'm retired. And that's how he gets out of a lot of things, that it gives him the free time. In a sense, he's more happy now that he's retired than when he had to teach class and had to go to faculty committee meetings and stuff like that.
Honors and recognition have become a part of Doc's life. Tied up at the New England Aquarium is the research vessel Edgerton, part of the Sea Grant program at MIT. Doc is one of the aquarium's founding members. The entire fifth floor here is a marine research laboratory named the Edgerton Lab, in tribute to his deep curiosity about the sea. Occasionally, Doc comes in to check up on special projects. At the Pacific Reef Tank, cinematographer Gene O'Connell and biologist Les Kaufman set up the high-speed camera and strobe to film how the butterfly pyramid fish eats.
The problem that we're working on here today has to do with the way fishes prey on minute sea creatures. An event that takes place in such a short time is a problem that I'm not skilled in. I don't know how to deal with the technology. You present it to Doc, and once he has a clear statement of your problem, it really takes him an amazingly brief time to pull the equipment together, to get the animals to cooperate, and bam, you have an answer to something that you've probably been puzzling over for the last 10 years.
All right, puff, real hard. Harder. All right, go. Great. Great.
Yep,
there he goes. All right.
Yep.
All right. Oh. That's it. You know, okay. 4 years we're in the dark. Now we'll finally know what's going on.
Well, good luck. It went so fast I couldn't really see what's going on.
Huh? No, I think
we'll have to look at the movies, see what happens.
At normal speed, all we see is that the food disappears. The high-speed camera slows down the action. Let's see it again. The biologist will study the film frame by frame to understand the mechanics of how the fish eat.
I think you know that we're having an open house for our graduate students in September. You might want to log that into your...
What's the date?
September. When I first came to MIT, I walked into Doc Edgerton's office and I found his whole life work here displayed before me. And when I went out into our laboratory, I found all of the things that have interested him, from high-speed photography to sonars. He's a many-faceted man, and many, many people that meet him are able to identify with him.
And he gets the echoes back.
Many students come here and think that there is nothing left to be done. Everything has been found, everything has been invented, and he doesn't believe that.
And this particular bat took his own picture by flying through this beam of light. And I was really proud of this, and I took it into my class. And one kid in the back says, "Hey, why don't you try to get a picture of the bat catching a bug?" And I said, "Well, that's impossible. It's enough trouble just to get the bat in the focus, but to get the bug in the bat." So the next class, this student came in with a worm-shooting cannon. That's Dave Callender, and here's his worm-shooting cannon. So there's no problem to get a bat and a worm. See it? No problem.
From this picture, scientists learn that bats don't catch prey in their mouths, but scoop them out of the air with their tail membranes.
All right, move it just a little bit, and just a trifle more. That's good.
I've worked with Doc for nearly 35 years. Doc is always the leader, and he knows what he wants to do, and he wants to do it quickly. Doc looks at time in terms of microseconds, and a student will come in and he'll ask for some of Doc's time, and Doc will say, "Okay, I'll give you 5 microseconds.
Something is very important in life. You have to get up in the morning and want to do it. And I used to tell people, if you don't wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning and you want to do something, you're wasting your time. Time is very precious. We're wasting it right now. I got through to you, didn't I?
Thank you.
This episode of Nova repeats Sunday at 6 Mountain Time, 5 Pacific.
Transcript of this program, send $4 to Nova, Box 322, Boston, Massachusetts, 02134. Please be sure to include the show title. Major funding for Nova is provided by this station and other public television stations nationwide. Additional funding was provided by Allied Corporation, a world leader in advanced technology products for the aerospace, automotive, chemicals, and electronics industries. And the Johnson & Johnson family of companies, supplying healthcare products worldwide. A companion book, Nova, Adventures in Science, published by WGBH and the Addison Wesley Publishing Company, is available in libraries and bookstores nationwide.